This was also a strength given to the division.
On the first slide, I would like to take you back 17 years in time to the year 1998, where two people, the postdoc and the PhD students, sat together and were discussing some miserably failed expression experiments. We wanted to express the GTPAs, and nothing seemed to work. So we had started with E. coli, of course, which didn't give satisfactory results. And we switched to yeast, and we also switched to the macular system, and neither of them worked as well, so it was pretty frustrating. E. coli, at least, had given us a quick feedback, so we knew it didn't work after just a few days. But with the other system, it had taken a lot longer, which was a high level of frustration. So we were really sitting together discussing why not having an expression system that combines the easiness of E. coli with the capabilities of the eukaryotic organism. When you look at the phylogenetic tree of all organisms, you realize there is a large kingdom of organisms situated directly at the border where prokaryotes and eukaryotes branch apart. And this kingdom of organism is called protistin. We didn't really know much about them, so we had a look at them, and we found quite a number of very scary organisms there, such as trypanosomes and leishmania and many others that caused a lot of human diseases. But one of them looked pretty interesting, and that was the organism Leishmania tarantula. And we started dealing with this organism. And first of all, that was the reason we chose it. It was one of the few organisms that was non-pathogenic from this kingdom, so it got a very easy S1 clearance in Germany and elsewhere. And also, the second benefit of this organism was it was very happy in any type of vessel, in any type of fermenter, so it's very easy to culture. And the third reason we decided to go for it. Leishmania tarantula has the full capabilities of any eukaryotic organism in terms of protein processing, protein folding, and also the full set of post-translational modification. And those three reasons, those three points, led us to use this organism for our expression project. And it didn't take very long, just about 10 years, until we had the system ready to work. And so Leishmania tarantula became Lexi, Leishmania expression system. And nowadays, we have shown that Lexi is suitable for basically any type of protein, no matter where it is situated in the cell. From the many expression projects we have run, we have calculated an expression success rate of about 80%. And we have reached titers for protein expression of about 0.5 gram per liter. This is quick and dirty experiments, so there's nothing optimized in there. And also now we have a cell-free version available, so basically working with extracts from Lexi cells and deal with them. So that was what we did. And then other people started getting aware of the system and started using it. So in the early days of 2004, it's pretty much our own papers that you see there. But in the course of time, other people established the system in their labs and started publishing papers. Today, the system is available in about 200 labs worldwide, many of them being academic research labs, of course, but also a number of biotech companies and also pharmaceutical companies have licensed in the system. So the number of published papers is increasing every year. And so at the moment it looks a bit like an exponential takeoff. I don't know, the funny thing about exponential takeoffs is you never know before, you only know in retrospect. So ask me again in 2 or 3 years' time, we'll know where this is going to go. And the last few minutes that I have left here, I just want to now show you some data, some experiments other people did with the system. Nothing that we did in-house, but what other people did with the system. At first, it's a fairly obvious application for a Lichtenberger expression system. People started the production of antigens to be used as potential vaccines. So there's a number of papers on the expression of viral antigens, including influenza, hepatitis, and papilloma virus. Of course, a very obvious approach is the production of recombinant antigens for Leishmania. Leishmania is still a major health problem in a lot of tropical and subtropical areas. With global warming and parasites migrating north, making them become a public health problem in a lot of other countries as well. And also the whole legacy cells that were used as a delivery vector in some sort of tumor exploration models. Another example I just want to put down here is expression of a number of cytokines, so interferon, interleukin, and that's an important case, the human recombinant human EPO was expressed in Lacey, erythropoietin, known to everybody since the Tour de France, of course. So the interesting part about the EPO is it's a glycoprotein. And so if you have a look at the gel down here, you see the EPO coming from the Lexi, and then when it is treated with some enzymes that deglycosylate, you see a shift in mobility, so clearly indicating full glycosylation. We did some fancy mass spec experiments on the glycopattern of EPO and could show that it's pretty much identical to the pattern of the EPO produced in CHO cells. You may have noticed the difference. So this is a reference standard of EPO from CHO cells. And EPO from CHO cells looks different. It's a smear. It's a fuzzy bend, it's not a sharp bend, indicating that CHO cell EPO consists of a number of different glycoforms. While this is not the case for Lexi EPO, you pretty much see a sharp bend here, indicating you have just one glycoform, and that's what we also could confirm by the mass spec experiments. So this directly takes me to the next slide, because the biological macromolecule that is very homogeneous is of course something interesting for anybody who is dealing with the structural biology. If you want to crystallize a protein, you don't want to deal with a non-homogeneous protein sample. You would rather prefer to work on homogeneous material, much easier for crystallization. And Lexi-derived proteins have now been used in structural biology, both in X-ray crystallography, but also in NMR. And there's quite a few papers published and some more work in progress going on there. And this, I briefly mentioned that before, it's a small side project of our Lexi work with the development of a cell-free system. So basically crunching, squashing, extracting the Lexi cells and working with the cell extracts in vitro or in vitro expression. And there's one example here that I wanted to point your attention to. There were some people who used in vitro Lexi to express the 0.6 megadalton large Hobbs complex, so consisting of six subunits. So that's all in vitro work that was done. And this pretty much leads me to the last slide. Just quickly jumping through, there is a number of other proteins expressed, so pathogen diagnostics for Toxoplasma gondii, some antibodies, single chain antibodies done with Lexi, and proteins such as coagulation factor 7, tissue plasminogen activator, and many more, just to name a few examples. And this is the people. These are the people working at Taylor Bioscience. This is the Lexi group. On the left hand side, Reinhardt. I want to use this opportunity to especially thank Reinhardt for staying with us and staying with this idea for now just sent them an email. That expression answered the questions. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Maybe one short question? Nope, there will be a coffee break. So, of course, I did a discussion with the W. We've heard a lot of expression systems, hopefully producing the protein and nothing else. We've heard that a sharp end in the SDS page might be beneficial. And so we'll come to the next part of the session, design of processes to control.